Talofalava Nisan Bolovinaka, welcome to this live Tagata Pasifika post-election special. If you watched the election results last night, why not have your say now? We'd love to hear from you, so hit us up on Facebook or Twitter and we'll try to get your feedback on screen. Well, it looks like National will be running the country for another term, and yes, they'll probably need help from minor parties, but really, they were the big winners on the night. Now, in a moment, Marama T-Pole will have all the reaction from our Pasifika MPs, but first, let's recap the results from last night. Here's John Utanga.
It was the nation's 51st election and a huge win for John Key and the National Party. They get to run the country for the next 3 years, on their own if they want, albeit with a wafer thin margin. Party vote provisional results saw National hose in on 48%, with Labour on 24%, the Greens on 10%, and New Zealand First improving on the last election with 8%. Translated to seats in the House, National gets 61, Labour 32, the Greens 13, and New Zealand First 11. The Māori Party gets 2 seats, while ACT and United Future get a seat each. National's win means they shouldn't have trouble firming up their position with the help of friendly minor parties. And it's good news for its 3 Pacific candidates as well. 2 will be returning to Parliament, while a 3rd, List MP Fia Turner, has a great chance of making it for the first time. If she does get in, there'll be 8 Pacific MPs in the House if you add Labour's 5, who all won electorate seats. While it's good news for Labour's Pacific support, it's one of the few silver linings for a party badly beaten in the polls.
Well, as you can see, we've got a big group here, so let me introduce you to them, and a lot of them have not had much sleep either, so yeah. First of all, from the National Party, we have Maunga Kiokia MP Pesita Sam Lotu'i'inga.
Talofalava and good morning to all viewers.
We have List MP Alfred Ngaro. Kia ora.
Kia ora tātou katoa, good morning.
And possible first-time List MP Fia Turner. Talofalava.
Talofalava and good morning.
From Labour, we have Mangere MP, Sua William-Seal.
Talofalava, marama, good morning.
New MP, Jenny Salesa, from Manukau East, Marole.
Marole, talofalava and greetings.
And Kelston MP, Kamau Sepuloni, talofalava.
Talofalava, marole.
And 2 more Labour MPs join us. Mana's Chris Fafoi from our Wellington studio. Maroni, Chris.
Maroni, good morning, everyone.
And in the Garden City, Christchurch East MP, Porto Williams. Kia ora.
Kia ora, good morning.
Well, welcome everyone. Thank you also for coming here so early in the morning after obviously a very late night for you. But first of all, Pesita, congratulations. A good one for you and also for the National Party.
Yeah, no, we had a good victory last night. But first, can I just congratulate all my fellow Pacific MPs? I just want to say it's great to have 8 MPs in the House going forward. But we're happy with our result in Maunga Kiokia, over 2,000 majority. But obviously, plenty of work to do going forward.
Alfred, I know you worked extremely hard there in Te Aratu, and you know, not much behind the sitting MP, Phil Tyford. How did you feel about your result?
Yeah, look, I'm just really proud of the team. And we went out there. In fact, I remember one of the guys sort of saying to us, well, you're really busy. And I said, the one thing about West Auckland, it's the home of the pioneers, with your Croatian, Pacific, Māori, European. And so therefore, you go hard or you go home. And that's what we did. We did it big, we did it hard, we went out there. And we got great support. We halved what was a majority of 5,500. So to us, we've increased the party vote. So, you know, it's a good result. It's not what we wanted, because we run to win. But, you know, we're encouraged.
Fia Turner, possibly in there on the list. How did you feel as you were watching the results last night for National?
Well, exciting, yeah, exciting. Because this is the first time a Pacific Island person was selected in Mangere, so it's a big job. Lefionga Sua has been the MP for, yeah, so it's the first time for National, and very exciting.
We'll go down the line now. First of all, to Chris and Mana. Well, you weren't on the Labour list. It was either win it or go home, I guess.
Yeah, we're obviously happy with the local result, but the overall result was what we were after. We're very happy we increased our majority by quite a bit. So thank you to the local team. But obviously we're going to have to go away and have a look at the national result and see how we can make that better.
Thank you, Chris. And also to you, Porto, a good second win for you there in Christchurch East.
Yes, and because we've had two campaigns in a very short time, I'm sure the team is looking forward to resting for the next little while before we get back on the horse and decide what we're going to do to make sure that we do better in terms of the party vote next time.
Okay, well, Jenny, you'll be the second Tonga now after Kaimo in Parliament. How does it feel?
I'm very humbled and very excited at Manukau East. We had a very big team of volunteers who have worked very, very hard since July, and we're really, really grateful for the result. Over 11,000 vote majority.
Okay.
So it's really great for us.
Thank you, Jenny, and congratulations as well to Kaimau. Thank you, Tom. Over to you now. That's some of the reaction from last night.
Well, thank you, Marama. Well, it was certainly an eventful night for our Pasifika MPs and their supporters. Senator Funalava Sanelia Chadwick checked in with National and Conservative Party candidates last night for this report.
Once every 3 years, the Onehunga Bowling Club bursts into a sea of blue.
You guys happy with the results so far?
Yes. Yeah, we're positive. Going well. We're happy. Yes.
Only the True Blue supporters make the trip to get behind their Mongakiakia MP.
It's been a tough campaign. You know, we've done a lot of work on the ground.
Yeah, it has been busy, but it's a real blessing because you have so many volunteers and people that just give so selflessly of their time.
Besitar's held the Mongakiakia seat since 2008. Prior to that, it was a Labour seat, but judging by the amount of True Blue supporters here tonight, that doesn't seem to be changing anytime soon.
Another MP on the move to win an electorate seat is National's Te Atatū candidate, Alfred Ngaro.
I'm a son of a migrant. I'm a first generation from Pacific. I mean, hard work is about how we sort of grew up. It's part of our culture, it's part of our values.
Te Atatū is a tough seat to win for any National candidate. It's been Labour since 1993, but despite the odds, it hasn't stopped the most dedicated of National supporters coming out to support Alfred Ngaro.
It's amazing. It's amazing what he'd done for him. And the wife helped him too to get through all this.
Despite losing the Te Atatū seat, Ngaro will be back in Parliament via the National Party list. However, the news wasn't so good over in the North Shore that a Conservative Party failed to make the 5% threshold.
This is a system where you've got to get 5%. We haven't managed to do that.
It's a funny feeling because you're not getting in because the threshold is a little bit higher than 5%, but then at the same time you're doing much better than people already in government. It was just a strange thing, actually.
It's a bitter blow for Edward Safi, but his support team remain optimistic.
Will you be back again in another 3 years' time to give it another crack?
I would love to be back. Love to be back. I'll see how my husband goes, but I'll love to do it again. I'll do it again for my people and I'll do it again for my children.
Okay, well, some great responses there. I first of all want to ask you, Besitar, I guess this election will be remembered for the party vote. Why do you think so many voters gave their party vote to National?
Well, I think, you know, New Zealand's doing well under National. We're doing well with jobs, 85,000 jobs in the last year alone, you know, 17,000 Pacific people employed in the last year. I think that resonates with people. We try to focus on the issues that matter, around jobs, around healthcare, around education.
How much inroads do you think you made into the Pacific vote? I know Key and you guys were talking about a lot beforehand.
Yeah, look, we're blessed with, you know, great support amongst Pacific people right around the country. It's certainly the feedback we got on the ground, and I think a good portion of that 48% are Pacific people, so we're really happy about that.
Alfred, what about issues like duty politics, the other things that were thrown at National throughout the campaign? Did that have an impact? What were people telling you in Te Atatū?
To be honest, Marama, people didn't actually talk about that. In fact, they got sick of the whole thing around the dirty politics and so forth. They actually wanted to get on to things that are most important to them. And in particular, if we're talking about our Pacific, one of the things that we've seen is that our retention and our completion rates in tertiary studies has increased. Our NCA results in level two have increased. Trades, apprenticeships, those things that are really important are the things that actually our people have been saying, actually, under National, we've seen an increase, we've seen an encouragement around, that's how that's making a difference. So actually, it wasn't in top of mind for our Pacifica people.
Well, Fia, it's possibly your first time as an MP. How tough was this campaign for you?
Oh, very tough. It was hard work. But we had a good team and we worked very hard because we believe in what we're doing and also supporting the National Party.
What about the issues with the Matai title that came up? Was that a problem for you?
No, not at all, because it's a family matter and that's my dad. So I inherited it from my father. So, yeah, no, not at all.
So you were here in the office at Amangere? Were you?
Look, firstly, just we had an amazing team of volunteers and all credit to them. But in terms of that question, I mean, I accept the fact that Fia does feel quite strongly about the Matai title, but there is only one law that administers all Matai Taitoa, whether Samoa or overseas, and no family is above that law that administers Matai Taitoa.
Okay, well, I'm going to come back to you for you. So, if this is your first term, what kind of things do you want to see happen while you're there?
Of course, important things like, you know, more jobs, also affordable housing, and also helping families. I've been helping families for nearly 20 years in Mangere. So, helping, like one of the values that the National Party has is strong families and caring communities, so just making sure the families are strong and
Fia's touched on the economy, and it's been talked about as a rock star economy, but we're not really seeing that trickle down to our Pacific communities, or
well,
are we?
Well, I disagree with that. We've seen average wages for Pacific people go up. We've seen more people in employment. You know, certainly, you know, on the ground that I'm talking to people, you know, Pacific people are doing well. We're doing better, and yeah, can we do better? Yes, and we will.
And I see you chuckling there, so we will come back to you and hear a bit more what our Labor MPs think, and also Chris and Porto down the line. But time now to head back to Tom with more from last night.
Thanks, Marama. Remember that you can have your say on last night's results. Just hit us up on Facebook or Twitter and we'll try to get your feedback on screen. Well, 3 years ago, Labour's Carmel Sepuloni was holding onto the Waitakere seat by the skin of her teeth. This time around, things were certainly different. Last night, John Pulu caught up with her and other MPs for this story.
After months of campaigning, Jenny Salesa and her supporters can finally taste victory.
It's a blessing that it's finally come to an end, because we have been working so hard out campaigning.
The Manukau East Labor MP says the hard work's definitely paid off.
Even though there has been several obstacles in the way, the main goal really is to get in and make a difference.
There's more Tongan candidates in this election. It's something these supporters are proud of.
I think that'll be a good voice for our people.
In Auckland CBD, it's a sombre mood as fellow Tongan Sitaleki Whinau commiserates on the demise of internet mana.
Being a novice to this political stuff, I'm learning very fast, and I think next time we're going to do better.
But the medical doctor's already working on a remedy for his return in the next election.
I'm trying to cross the gap between the rich and the very poor. The filthy rich owns New Zealand, and we want the clean poor people to own New Zealand.
Meanwhile, in West Auckland, Carmel Sepuloni celebrates winning her electorate, but it's with mixed feelings.
It's bittersweet because, you know, the ultimate was for Labor to become government again, and unfortunately we've missed that one.
No such concerns for her supporters, though.
We should have our Pacific MP so they can help the Pacific people have our voice in New Zealand government.
A positive vote to mark another historic election.
So obviously still some strong support there from Pacific people there with Labor, but let me bring you into it. Chris, what did you feel about people when you were talking to them and you were up against, you know, senior national MP as well?
Oh, look, it went pretty well. We increased our majority by about 4,200, so we're happy with that. But as you saw in your picture, in your pictures before, in your story before, that obviously we need to look at why their party vote didn't go our way, and we need to do better on that. But out on the streets, it felt good. So we're happy. It's only 10 to 8 on the Sunday morning after, so we're still yet to really have it sink in.
Carmel, I could see you were, you know, really upset there last night. Obviously, you know, happy to win the Carlton seat and be back. But what did you feel about the result overall?
Yeah, I mean, it is bittersweet. I think I was saying this back in 2008, to be back in Parliament, but for Labor to lose the election. And I have to say, you know, we're not out to win for the sake of just winning. We do believe that Labor is best for our people, and we do believe there's a lot at stake. And so that's...
But Stuart, I want to bring this question over to you now. Do you think that the public didn't believe you? I mean, obviously, we can see everybody was, you know, cheerleaders for you at your Labor Party events and on the roadsides, but what went wrong?
I think there's a whole range of things that we probably need to have a review on and reflect on. I think, given the fact that David Cunliffe only came into the campaign a year out from election day, all credit to him for his perseverance and his determination. But these things are long term, so I'm looking forward to 2017. I think we do need to regroup. I think there are issues and matters that, as a Labor caucus, we need to be discussing about how serious we want to be in government. But I also think that we've got to be better engaged with the wider community. If you've ever seen what we did out in Mangere, you know, follow the labour, labour, follow the labour, that was a way of engaging with our young people who are the future of this country.
You still lost some votes to National, even in the Mangere electorate. Were you surprised about that? I mean, you know, there was a lot of talk by, you know, Key and National that that would happen.
Oh, look, National pulled out all the stops and bombarding Mangere with high-level visits with Fia and her group, but I think our vote held strongly. Whilst there was a huge swing to National in all other electorates, you'll find that in Mangere, Manurewa, in Manukau East, and I think in Kelston, we held true. And I think.
What about still some seats, like for example Cunliffe, even Mount Roskill? You know, the party vote on so many key seats we can see has been given over to National. Are people not really interested in Labor anymore?
Oh, I think we've got a lot of work to do there. And as I said, I think Cunliffe came into this election a year out from Election Day. We've had internal issues with our leadership, and I think that's the part that we've got to reflect
upon. I'm wondering if it's not just leadership. Like, do you think Pacific people and the wider public, are they interested in the policies?
I don't believe it. I think our policies resonated strongly, certainly in our campaign in Mangere.
What were you going to say there?
Can I say the fact is that, look, we're first, second and third generation now. We've got more educated, more articulate, and what they now our young people are saying to us, actually there are other options. So that's reflected right across the board. You've seen Ed Saafi, for instance, Mike Elliot Ikile, which is with the Conservative Party. You've seen Setiliki Finau, Makali Singata. Like, Pacific are changing, and if the messages don't change, then what happens is that we're going to lose that. What we're seeing, a lot of young Pacific are actually starting to see, actually National has the values and the vision that actually is aspirational. It talks about the things that they can see, that it can better their circumstances, and we've constantly seeing that as well coming through.
But we do have to be careful, Marama, that we don't become individualistic and become educated and aspirational for ourselves and forget about the other end of the scale where we have a lot of Pacific people that are actually...
We're going to actually come into some of those questions. We've got some comments directly from the community for our MPs, and we've grouped them into three separate areas. So here are some questions and comments from our public. Here's the first one.
According to the Poverty Monitor statistics of 2011, 285,000 young people are currently living in poverty.
Most of us Pacific Islanders, we have low-income families, you know. We have children that, you know, they don't have food, you know. They don't eat lunch when they go to school.
Can do anything better for the community and the people, for New Zealand and young people, families.
What are you as politicians or as candidates going to do to change these statistics?
So, Pistel, I'm going to bring that question first to you to answer. What are you going to do in this next term?
Well, as I've already said in the program, you know, the best way out of poverty, out of welfare, is to get into work. And so many of our people now are getting into work. Over 111,000 Pacific people today are working. And that work gives you the ability to look after your families, to look after not just you as an individual, but your communities.
Our Pacific community are still more than double the mainstream. In terms of unemployment, our Pacific community who are out of work are still twice the numbers of mainstream. Are the policies not working then for perhaps our community?
I think, well, as I said, you know, in the last year alone, 17,000 Pacific people have got a job. I think, you know, we're starting to see Pacific people be better educated. With better education actually comes, you know, higher paying jobs. Those are the things that we came here as migrants to do. I think we're starting to see that, and Alfred talked a little bit about the statistics around tertiary education and skills training.
We'll come into some more of those issues here now. Moving along, here's another area of concern for the community.
I've got one thing for the MP should be more opportunities for jobs and stuff like that.
Now we're looking at people taking up from the benefit and pushing them to go into the employment or the workforce. But where are the work, you know?
Because I'm in the building industry, I'm roofing, so...
Just want jobs for the kids that are window washing.
I want people to build investment properties.
What's unique that they can do and attribute to our community, especially for the young people, and job seeking.
There we go. So what you've heard just then about jobs, what are you hearing in Mangere as well?
Oh, look, I mean, the aspirational message is a message that Pacific people have come here with. And you can only aspire and are able to lift yourself from the situation there if the opportunities are there. Currently, those opportunities are missing. And so the challenge lies squarely now on my colleagues who have won the government benches about delivering for those communities who have said they do need support, they do need jobs, they do need higher incomes, and they do need affordable housing.
Also, Chris, down the line, anything you want to add as well, especially a lot of issues there in Christchurch too?
Yes. Look, I have to say, in Christchurch, the opportunities are here for our people. Unfortunately, those people who aren't in work, who aren't doing so well, are our people. And it's really unfortunate. This should be the time of opportunity for all of our people in Christchurch with the rebuild and the opportunities that are here. There is a real disconnect between those that are doing well and those that are doing not. We're seeing it very starkly here in Christchurch.
OK, well, Puta, we're going to go to one more group of questions from our community. Here they are.
What are the strategies that you guys have in place to address Pasifika housing issues?
More housing for those people who really need it, especially, you know, Housing New Zealand should actually play a part in that.
Even saving for the next 10 years won't get us anywhere with the help. John Key says that he's going to give us an extra 20 grand, but even that's not going to help because then you're still in debt for the rest of your life.
59%. Of Pasifika people who live in New Zealand don't own houses. What are you guys doing to address this issue?
Jenny Manukau East, what were you hearing from people as far as housing? Can people who live in Manukau East, can they afford to buy a house there?
So many of our people can't even afford to buy a house, and so many are actually suffering in terms of rent. We door knocked on thousands and thousands of houses in Otara, Otahuhu, and some in Papatoetoe, and housing is actually the number one issue for our people in general. They just don't, you know, earn enough money. Not enough money is coming in for housing affordability, and they're asking, can it be addressed? And the challenges to this current government, you know, there's the housing accord here in Auckland right now. Has it delivered? No, I don't think so. It hasn't actually delivered, not in Manukau East.
Looking ahead, sorry, Alfred, what do you want to mention about that with the housing?
I just want to say the fact is that, look, Michael Bassett wrote a report in 2013. Housing affordability and also the issues around housing have been happening since 1974. So this is a long-term issue. Housing affordability is about land supply. What the government is doing quite clearly here is ensuring that with this housing accord, it's made sure that we're freeing up land supply, and it's a lot more complex than that. It's around construction, it's around what's called building material costs. We've suspended the tariff at the moment on anti-dumping tariffs. Those sorts of things are part of a very complex issue, but we believe we're making a difference.
Still afford to, I mean, even a lot of average Kiwis can't even afford to put, you know, to buy a house with the prices these days.
Yeah, look, you know, we've addressed that through the housing accords with the mayor and
no,
the council.
Well,
we have. Well, you might disagree with that.
People in Manukau East would disagree with that.
Well, you know, house prices went up. It doubled under Labor in the last 9 years.
It is on average $700,000 to buy a house in Auckland now.
So, you know, do you think people can afford to buy a house? Like, I know you said a year or two ago that, you know, they're affordable in Mangakeke.
Some are affordable in Mangakeke, and I'm quite proud that actually we're releasing land and building more homes in Mangakeke and across the whole of Auckland.
I'm wondering if you're disconnected from a lot of our Pacific community who just can't even afford to buy a house, or even average Kiwis.
Look, we're not saying it's easy. It is difficult to buy a house in Auckland. And that's why we're not focused, you know, on saying how bad it is. We're trying to do something about it. We're working with the local council, we're working with developers, and we're bringing down the cost of building homes through development contributions legislation, through reducing tariffs, and by getting the sector up and running. $43 million into trades training for Pasifika and Māori. We're getting our people employed to get into that industry in order to build more houses.
I'm going to bring Porto in. Will that help in Christchurch, Porto?
Well, Pesita is absolutely right. National is not concentrating on how bad it is. It is absolutely extraordinary what our folk here in Christchurch are experiencing. Let's face it, we have to pay the same level of rents that you do in Auckland, but our disposable weekly income is much less. So we're finding our families, you know, overcrowded. It's an absolute crisis for us here, and the government actually needs to do what we said we would do, which is build houses. You cannot rely on the market, and you cannot rely on lines on a map to solve the problem. You actually need to build. The government is a powerful institute with a lot of resources behind it, and it needs to actually start building houses.
Thank you,
Porto,
and thank you for your comments, and also to Chris down the line. Well, there you have it. That's just the beginning of, I think, a lot of debates that we're going to have in the future. Thank you all for coming on the show. Really appreciate it. And we'll come to the end of our post-election special. Thank you for joining us today. Thank you.
Well done.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, we've got 1 minute.
Everybody in the world, you got to do the right thing. Do the right thing. Right thing. Gotcha.